most of the things that people grow in their garden for beautiful flowers are just mutants, and what you give your loved one on Valentine's Day is some horrible homeotic mutant in which all the sex organs have been converted to petals. Like roses should only have, in wild, roses only has 5 petals. And so all those extra petals came from somewhere, and they came from conversions of the sexual organs, the male and female, the stamens and carpels, into additional petals. So next time you give your loved one a rose or carnation, you're just giving them a horrible homeotic mutant for Valentine's Day. I'm originally from Montana, which is in the northern Rockies in the United States, just north of Yellowstone National Park, where I grew up. But it's cold. My parents were very avid outdoors people. We would go out all the time and camp. Just the combination of geology and biology and being outside, I've always been interested in how the diversity of the life arose. And so eventually, it took me many years, but we're coming back to evolution now in the lab. These represent a member of the basal lineage of liverworts. You can think of it as potentially retaining some ancestral characters of what plants first looked like when they crawled onto land. All of the plants and animals we eat don't look anything like what their wild ancestors do, and that's because what we've done is we've done selected particular organisms to go to the next generation with the traits that suit humans, oftentimes not suiting their life in the wild. The latest discovery we made with the genes controlling the different generations, that's actually of interest to agriculture in general because they like the idea of maintaining hybrid seed without sex. Most people try to think about their own life cycle. We have a body. It's diploid, which means it has 2 copies of every chromosome. And if you're female, you produce eggs through meiosis, and eggs have a single copy, they're haploid. And males will produce sperm, which have a single copy of the chromosomes, and also being haploid. And when those two meet up again, they make a zygote, a diploid cell, which eventually forms the embryo and a new generation. In land plants, they have a diploid body that produces haploid progeny, which, and the haploid progeny have their own multicellular bodies and lives. It would be as if our sperm and eggs, we produced them, they developed into multicellular organisms, went out to the pub, met, mated, produced the next generation without our diploid bodies ever knowing. One goal would be for each farmer to produce their own hybrid seed. It's more important for places where there are subsistence farming. If they could boost their yield by growing hybrids and not having to purchase the hybrid seed, it would be great. Until about 1900, botany and medicine were inextricably linked. And that was because most of our drugs come from plants. In fact, Marcantia has secondary compounds that are antimicrobial or antifungal. There's other ones that are being used as anti-cancer drugs or tested for that. And so there's this diversity of chemicals out there that nature has already made. Hopefully it'll eventually come full circle again and botany will be as valued as it once was. The more we learn about how organisms are related to one another, the more we realize how almost all of our efforts in the past have been focused just on a few little lineages of life. And yet there's all kinds of diversity out there that we didn't really appreciate.